If you are thinking about getting into building VTOLs, this is the name you should know. Matek Systems F405 VTOL on the channel today. We're going to give you a brief overview of this flight controller, just show you where things go. And if you're thinking about building a VTOL, this is a great video to watch.
Now, I don't want you to get too intimidated right off the bat because I want to walk you guys sort of into this side of the FPV hobby. And if you're watching this video, you're probably interested in at some point maybe building your first VTOL. Just to give you a little bit of background, there are a lot of flight controllers out there now that support VTOL types of setups and different types of firmware that you can put on these flight controllers to make VTOL work properly, such as inav configurator now supports VTOL, which is super great, and also ardupilot, the old school standard. Years ago, we were using ardupilot for VTOL types of setups, and there are several different types of flight controllers that support VTOL systems as well. You have plug and play systems such as this one that everything can kind of plug into place. You don't have to do any soldering. Even the pins are here for PWM, which is super, super cool. And on this one, you have to solder on the pins themselves. And they give you some pins inside these kits, usually red, white, and black. That's just your ground, 5 volt or 9 volt, and your signal wire. Usually the signal is going to be on a white pin. So if you keep those in order, this will be a nice color representation when you're plugging in servo leads and things like that. But what are the options of something like the Matek Systems F405 VTOL board? This is the larger one with more options, and they have a smaller version, more compact 20 by 20 version of an F405 VTOL as well, which I think is super cool. So the mini version and the full size version here. Let's just go ahead and let me show you what this one's all about a little closer up and kind of walk you through what things are around this board. If you're interested in this one, you can find this one in the link down below if you want to grab one and just start soldering and playing around with VTOL. It's a lot of fun. There's also another video that I did recently with the Speedybee wing version. So that one's cool. That one works with an app, which is a lot of fun to be able to change things. And that one supports now inav inside the Speedybee app native. So that's kind of different than this one that you're going to see today. But without further ado, let's go ahead and jump right into the first layer of this stack. So when you first get started with your VTOL build, this is the board you want to start with first. Usually what I do is I start with my battery terminal wires here, and this flight controller can actually handle from 2 to 6S, which is pretty nice. That's going to be about 6.8 volt all the way up to 30 volt you can power this board to. And it has 4 ESC inputs individually on these terminal tabs here, so ground and positive. And it is switchable from 9 volt to 12 volt. If you turn this little dongle right here, you put two basically pieces of solder here that bridge over, it will make this 12 volt for all of your power inputs there. That's kind of nice. You also have all your signals coming up to the flight controller from this harness here, and this will plug into the top board, which we'll talk about soon. The top plate has a mounting point of 44 by 20. 29 millimeters, and the bottom PDB here is mountable at 45 by 42 millimeters square. The current sensor on your PDB is located right here, and this current sensor can go up to 100 amp continuous and 220 amp peak level power. So you can have some pretty big ESCs running power through this board. You also have more power options down here in the bottom right-hand corner. You can change it from 7.2 volt to 6 volt to 3 volt, and you have an extra ground over here. And you even still have more power over here, another 5 volt and ground tab sneaking in right next to this chip. And just above the PDB, you have the flight controller. This is going to mount into this harness, and it has to be mounted a certain way, or you will have things backward in inav and ardupilot. You want to be careful about the way you mount things. So you want to make sure that all the pins plug in. You're plugging things in, and you're going to have to take off 4 small screws to be able to plug in your harness and get this off here. And push down, making sure that everything is in line here, side to side. It's kind of tricky, so just take your time doing that. When you press that all the way down like that, you should have a solid connection. And again, this board has an arrow facing forward, so you'll mount this just like this, and you'll put those 4 screws on the bottom that I took off. back on, and now I can walk you through the flight controller itself. Now, the first thing I generally do before I install a flight controller to any model, aircraft, or VTOL, wing, or plane, what I do is plug in the connector for the USB port, and I flash it with the latest version of either inav or ardupilot. So there is a little harness down here. I thought it was this one, but that's not it. That's an extra port there for like GPS or otherwise. We're gonna plug that in, and now we have USB access to the flight controller. So this is a nice little PCB breakout right here that has a few extra options here. We have a buzzer. It's not an external battery buzzer, which I always recommend for these types of builds, but it will act as a buzzer, which is great. When this plugs in on this side, it also gives you access to the USB port there. It has a boot button, and it also has an on-off switch. So if you're sitting there working in inav and sometimes the beeper won't stop beeping, you can reach over and turn off your beeper. Just don't forget to turn it back on when you fly your aircraft. Now, this is where the fun really begins, and this is where I get really excited with these types of flight controllers. This flight controller has up to 12 PWM outputs, which is pretty amazing. That means that you can run 11 servos and the addition of LEDs on your aircraft, which is pretty fun. So I think 11 servos will be enough for most of you guys. So yeah, we also have one 12C output. And we have four ADC VBAT current sensor tracking and airspeed, and one spare PTOT tube style input on this board as well. And what's also cool is right off the top, you should know there is dual inputs for cameras. So if you have one camera go black on you, you can flick a switch in inav on your radio and go into your alternate camera system. So that's pretty cool. It also has a built-in inverter on UART2 for RX S-Bus input. So it also supports ELRS and TBS crossfire on this. And also in the box with this, you get some extra hardware as well as a capacitor and an extra set of wires. It has four wires coming off it for this extra sensor input right here. So if you want to add other things on here, you can with this option right here. It's kind of nice. It's a little plug and play option. It's the only one on this board besides the plug-in USB on the underside of this flight controller. And also, this flight controller comes packing more things. It has four extra BEC outputs here. We have 5-volt, 9-volt, we have BEC VX output for servos, and we have BEC 3.3 output for barometer and compass, which is kind of cool. And again, the physical mounting points on this are 25 by 25 on this top plate right here, as well as the main board just below it is 45 by 42 millimeters by 15 millimeters tall. And this whole flight controller and PDB together with the USB cable and the extra PCB for the USB-C port, it all weighs in at only 25 grams, which is super light. So now let me give you a very simple explanation of what you're looking at right here. This looks super complicated, I know. If you've never seen this before, you're probably looking at your screen going, seriously, Justin, how am I even going to comprehend what is going on here? But just bear with me, because a lot of this is very similar, if not the same, as a lot of quad setup. If you've ever built a quad and you soldered up an S-Bus receiver, for example, S-Bus is right here. This is the signal port. You got a 5-volt or 4-volt tab here for positive wire, which is your red wire, and your black wire is on green, gray right here. So ground wire, so black, red, and a yellow or a white cable. So that's your S-Bus port right there for S-Bus. The S-Bus configuration will be serial 6. So UART 6 should be where S-Bus is, as well as crossfire. But you can also put crossfire on TX2 and RX2 right over here on this bottom rail, TX2 and RX2. Just don't forget to swap your wires. If you don't see something working, the sticks inside ardupilot or inav in your channel maps, switch these two wires, and a lot of times that receiver will start working once you have it bound up to your module and your radio. And you have 5-volt here along these rails, as well as more grounds over here. VX S11, that's that serial port for the signal on the 11th PWM port right there. So remember how we talked about 11 to 12 types of different inputs for servos and other doodads and gizmos you want to put on this board? But that's how you're going to hook up crossfire and S-Bus. They also have options for SRX L2 if anybody's using that. on the 4-volt and 5-volt on TX2 right there. So if you want to add that type of receiver, you can do that as well. So it'll support S-Bus, ELRS, FreeSky. It'll support Futaba, just about any type of receiver that you want to bind up to this. As long as it's selectable in inav and ardupilot, this flight controller will support it. Now, if you are wiring up GPS and you're not using a plug-and-play GPS, which the other flight controller that I showed you had, this is the way you're going to do that. You can grab an M10 GPS. It does support that natively. Those can get up to 30 satellites, so that's the one that I suggest. And what you can do is you can come up to this top rail right here, and you can come in on a 5-volt tab for power. We have 5-volt over here if you want, or 5-volt here. And all along this right here, we have TX5 down, actually on the second rail down here is where you'll put it. So we'll come in along this rail right here, and that will be where you put your GPS. And you'll do your red wire here, black, your DA wire, CL, TX5, and RX5. And the same thing with GPS. If you don't see packets coming in, you don't see anything happening in your GPS tab in inav, you want to switch TX5 and RX. Same thing like crossfire. Now, if you're looking at the very back of the flight controller right here, we have these rails and they are separated, which is kind of cool. It kind of gives things a little bit more visual organization. And a lot of times, if you look closely, these will have square or round holes. And the way that works is this sort of rounded square, that's going to be your ground style wire. So the black ones will usually plug into the rounded square holes. The power squares are going to have sharp corners on them for 5-volt, 9-volt, like here. Signal wire holes are usually going to be completely round. So if we just kind of look along here, you can see current there, VTX, and these are the signal holes and ports for signal. So if you see a rounded square, that's usually going to be ground. And that's just a quick way to identify things. And up here, the same thing. So you see signal wires are completely round, your VX power right there, and your ground with the rounded square. So down here at the very bottom on the far left, this is pretty cool. You see ground 5-volt C2 and C1. What's that? Well, that's camera 1 and that's camera 2. So hey, that's pretty awesome. You can have two cameras plugged into this flight controller at once. So if you're flying and you have a switch that's dedicated to camera control, you can flip back and forth from camera 1 to camera 2. Say you have one out on the wing, or you just have one as a redundancy, as a backup. So that's pretty cool. Or you could even have a camera facing backwards and look from where you're going. If someone's kind of tailing you and doing some follow along footage, that would be pretty neat to be able to see who's following you. Or if you just have that pesky police control drone chasing you down, you can now look and see that guy chasing you, but don't try that at home. Also, over on this board over here, we have a VTX input as well. So we have ground 9-volt for VTX here. This is your VTX signal wire here. And just one over, we have extra TX6 and RX6 here, TX4 and RX4 for extra types of sensors. Now, airspeed sensor doesn't come along with this board, but you can buy one from Matek separately, and that will plug into this harness right here. There are two air intake tubes that come in, and you will just put them somewhere on the outside of your aircraft, and then when air comes and flows through into the sensor itself, that data gets fed right into here and will be displayed right on your OSD, which is pretty cool. And just a second ago, I talked about TX6 and RX6, TX4 and RX4. That's where we can wire up our HD VTX. If you want to put Walk Snail, or say you want to put HD0 on here, or even DJI or something like an Air Module or O3 or Cadex Vista, you can start here with ground, 9-volt, and you can do TX4 and RX4 right there. That will get you going with your HD type of VTXs and camera operating systems. And again, for HD FPV users, it doesn't matter which UART you decide to put this on. You can put it on any spare UART. Your OSD is going to work on any spare UART. So just make sure that you have your PWM active inside the inav configurator in the ports tab. If that's active, then it should show up. But otherwise, you may not have OSD. If you don't, switch these two wires, and sometimes it would just come up as long as you have that active. Now, if you'd like to go into inav configurator and play around with some of the settings in this board, go ahead and hook up your cable here and plug in your USB port. This has to be a data cable, by the way, so we're just going to plug this in, and if you hear it beep, if you don't want to hear it beep, you can turn that off. So that's kind of a nice option. Now, once inside inav, maybe you installed the firmware already and restarted your computer. If you're on a PC, you may need to install drivers. We're going to select Matek F405 TESD right there, and we're going to select 0.6.11, and once that's done, we're going to go ahead and load the firmware, and we're going to hold down the boot button first. We're going to disconnect real quick. We're going to go all the way down to the bottom here, and we're going to reconnect in DFU mode, and you will see it up at the top here in DFU mode. Now we're going to go ahead and say flash firmware, and we're putting the newest version of the firmware on here, and these are my settings up top. No reboot sequence or anything like that. Just a standard flashing. First thing it's doing is erasing the entire flight controller, and now it's flashing with the latest version on here. So once you plug this in for the first time and you go to the firmware flasher setting, it should show you which target that they want you to go to. So this top part will be the flight controller that you're gonna flash, and it will show you that. And then you can just select the latest version from the list, which we're gonna do, which is from 6/14/2023. Once it does its flashing procedure, you can go ahead and let go of the boot button. And now I can let go, it says successful. And now we can unplug the board. And again, I turned off my buzzer here. We can plug this back in, and I have my beeper turned off here so that it doesn't buzz at me every single time. You can see the LED status changed there, and on the screen in inav configurator, you'll see that the USB modem is set there. So go ahead and click connect. And now you're in the main setup for inav on this flight controller. And if you move the flight controller back and forward and left and right, you'll see that it moves corresponding on the screen. And I have to tell you, if you want to calibrate your accelerometer, make sure you have a flat and level surface to do it on. And this is a good time to do it when you're going through the basic settings for your flight controller before you put it in your aircraft. It will save you so much trouble of trying to have a USB cable plugged into your aircraft and move your entire aircraft around on the bench. Much easier to calibrate it here in the calibration tab here before you get started. So you go through all these steps, 1 through 6 right here, on all the different axes of this flight controller. And that way it's pre-calibrated before you even put it inside your aircraft. And that'll save you a lot of time. We also have other tabs here for mixer. You can change the platform configuration. You can go to outputs here for your different types of ESC firmware protocols. We have one shot through DShot 600. And right now I don't have any ESCs, so we're just gonna leave it at one shot. And here I can go in and I can change, depending on which my, say, HD VTX was on. Say it was on UART4, I could turn on MSP. And I may have said PWM earlier because I've got PWM on the brain, but I meant to say MSP. Make sure you have MSP active, and then you want to go over to peripherals and select DJI FPV VTX. That way you have your HD OSD showing up in your goggles too, or your V2 goggles. So that's pretty cool there. And you have up to 6 UARTs there for different sensors and different things, which is also kind of cool. And over in the configuration, we can play around with the sensor and buses, voltage regulation, board sensor alignment. We have it set to 0 because we're just going to put it in straightforward in the center of the gravity of the aircraft. You have other features down here, and this is a great program. You can really get deep if you want to. Once you put GPS on there, you can select return to home on a switch for fail safe as well down in your different types of flight control switches. PID tuning in here, you're not going to do a lot of PID tuning on the VTOL, honestly. Advanced tuning, you probably won't get into that either. You can go into some programming if you know how to program, and your receiver tab as well to be able to select different types of receivers, ELRS or TBS Crossfire. So it takes a minute for things to load in inav. It's not quite as quick as Betaflight, but you can change the receiver type from serial, MSP, SIM here, and CRSF is pre-selected at the very top, and it goes all the way down this list right here. A bunch of different types of receivers are available inside inav configurator, which is cool. And modes here, so make sure you add an arm mode. You're gonna want to do that before you add anything else, but we can have return to home on a switch here. We can have camera control as well, that I talked about before, and they have up to, like, looks like 3 different camera control ranges here. So if you flip one position, 1, you've got camera control 1, camera two, and that's how you would do that. Sort of like adding acro and other modes for multi-rotors. And here is where you're gonna check on your GPS. You'll see packets loading up in here, and it will show you exactly where you're located, which is kind of cool. We also have a barometer on this board, and you can play around with the magnometer. Mission control here, which we're not gonna do. And again, an OSD. I don't see any HD settings inside the OSD for inav at this point, but maybe, hopefully coming up in the future. Maybe my up version needs to be updated. There is a brand new 7 coming out. inav 7 configurator should be out very soon. You have LED strip control, and you can go wild in here, but I love inav. The fact that it's very familiar and it seems very similar to Betaflight. So if you've already been working in Betaflight, this won't be too hard for you. It will be hard to start, but I promise you it gets easier. We also have black box support on this flight controller as well. We have an SD card slot, and you can turn that on and off inside the inav configurator. But those are the basics of calibration and configuration and ports tabs inside inav, and it's just a basic kind of walkthrough of this program. I suggest downloading it and just going through it a tab at a time here and becoming familiar with it. The more you play around in inav, the closer you'll be to flying an FPV plane, wing, or a VTOL. And if you want more information on firmware updates and just tutorials in general on different flight controllers and now VTOL flight controllers and FPV racing flight controllers, we do a lot of it right here on this channel. So be sure to stay tuned and subscribe. Click the notification bell for when new products and overviews like this one come out. Guys, take care. I'm Justin Davis. You can check out my link down below if you want to grab one of these and start playing around. This is a ton of fun and a whole new world. I'll see you on the next one.